Good morning. Welcome to all of you for today's session. So yesterday's class we saw Coulomb's law and we also saw what is the meaning of electric field intensity, and I told you to visualize. If you have a point charge, you can imagine the field to be around the point charge. It is just diverging, you know, because the field will, if you take a point anywhere, the field at that point will be the line joining these two points. So if I take the field in all directions, it will radiate away from the point charge. So I hope you remember when I spoke about divergence, I had told you that divergence literally means that, you know, a particular field diverges from a point. So electric field intensity, or we loosely call it as electric field E, the electric field vector E actually has a divergence, right? So, and we saw how to calculate this field, and some of the properties of the field we saw was that it is a vector, and it has almost a similar structure to your Coulomb's law. So it falls off, it's proportional to the charge which is causing the field, and it falls off as the inverse ratio of the square of the distance between the point under consideration and the point where the charge is located. And then we also defined, we also saw how to do problems with, you know, using the field E, and we saw how to solve for the field in cylindrical coordinates or in spherical coordinates. Today's class would be an extension of the learning objectives we defined yesterday. So we will be seeing some continuous charge distributions. So what is the meaning of a continuous charge? So I told you a point charge is located at a single point in space. Now think of a conductor, a very thin wire which is charged. You can say it is like a line charge, okay? Or you think of a sheet of metal which is charged uniformly. So then it becomes a surface which is charged. Or you think of a thick volume. Okay, you think of a conductor itself, but it is very thick. So it has got a volume. It is more or less like a cylinder. Now supposing it, the charge is there in the cylinder uniform, then it becomes a volume charge. Clear? So these are called as continuous charge distributions because the charge is located, you have a charge spread out at every point on the configuration under consideration. Are you clear? So if I just take a conductor and I have charges here and there, then it doesn't become a line charge because it will become a group of point charges. So in a line charge, the line is uniformly or non-uniformly also, it is charged. So we will consider these charge configurations in today's class and see some interesting results with them. So first let us see how we describe or how we define. First, a line charge, a filament-like distribution such as in a cathode ray tube or a charged conductor of a small radius, right? So let us say you have a stream of electrons, then that becomes a line charge, like you have in a CRT, or if I have a very thin wire conductor. So normally, if it is uniformly charged, the line charge is defined or quantified by its charge density. Charge density is either denoted by lambda or by rho with a suffix L. So rho is normally used for charge and L stands for line, and we would use an S for surface and a V for volume. But I am trying to avoid it so that, you know, because rho is also the radial distance in cylindrical coordinates. So I have found that sometimes it leads to confusion, but I will be using these terminologies also so that you know that these are also commonly used. Clear? So what will be the unit? Since it is a line charge, the unit is so many coulombs per meter. Okay? So that is a line charge. Now you think of a surface charge. So you have a sheet, you have a surface. It could be a plane, or it could be a sphere, a hollow sphere whose surface is charged. So the charge is spread uniformly on a surface. So it is denoted by either sigma, or as I told you, by rho s, rho with the suffix s, s for surface, or rho with the suffix a, a for area. So these are the common nomenclatures used for a surface charge, and it is denoted by the surface charge density. So the unit of the surface charge density is coulomb per meter square. Coulomb per meter square. Okay. Next, I have a volume charge. So you think of the same sphere, right? Instead of hollow, it's a solid sphere, and the charge is spread throughout the sphere. That becomes a volume charge. So the charge is distributed uniformly over a volume, and the unit is given by coulombs per meter cubed. Okay, and normally the nomenclature used is rho v, v for volume. Okay, so what would be the total charge? See, in case of point charges, we said it is a charge of 10 nanocoulombs, it is a charge of 20 nanocoulombs, and so on, right? Minus 30 nanocoulombs. But here I am talking of a wire and charged, and it is lambda coulombs per meter. So if I have 10 meters of the wire or filament, it would be lambda into 10, right? Or I can say it is integral of lambda into dl. Remember, integral is accumulation. So it is integral lambda dl. Similarly, for the surface charge, the total charge would be, the charge q would be integral of sigma ds, right? Because it is spread over an area. And with volume charge, the total charge would be integral of rho v into dv. That is integral of the volume charge density over the taken over the entire volume. So in this way, you can find out what is the total charge q within a line charge or a specified surface charge or a specified volume charge. So now first let us take line charge. So let us find the field due to a finite line charge, right? Finite means the length is finite. We'll make a general derivation, okay, and then extend it to something else in an easier form. Now consider a line. Let us assume, for simplicity, I want you all to pay attention to this figure. There are different ways it can be derived. I have tried to give you the simplest derivation. So this is an XY plane I am taking. Let us assume that our line charge is lying on the X axis. Please remember, this has no nothing wrong in it, and the results will not be any different because of this assumptions. So I am just taking a particular configuration. So I am taking a line along the X axis, okay, charged uniformly with lambda coulombs per meter. And please, I want to draw your attention to the nomenclature I have used here. Right, the line, the total length of the line is L, capital L I have used. Now I want to find the field at any point P. I want to find the field at any point P due to this finite line charge. Clear? And again, look at these figures. So what I am doing is, I am considering an elemental, a very small length here given by dx. I am taking a very small length dx, which is at a distance x from one end. So the remaining is L1, it will be L minus x. Okay. And here I am dropping a perpendicular from the point under consideration, and this perpendicular distance I call it as h. Remember, yesterday we did this problem. If I have two point charges, what is the field at the perpendicular bisector? So this is the perpendicular height. Okay. And now I have taken a small radius r, right? This r is the radial distance, the radius from this, the distance from this small element dx to the point under consideration. Okay. Now I have joined these two lines here, the two ends also to the point. So let us assume the left end makes an angle alpha 1 and the right end makes an angle alpha 2, and this external angle I have called as beta. So I am setting the premise of the geometry for my derivation. Geometry plays an integral part in many field derivations, right? So quickly, I have a line of length L located on the x-axis, and I'm considering an elemental length dx from one end, and which is at a distance of x, and this dx is like a point charge because dx is very small. So the charge in that length, I can assume it to be a point charge. So this is connected to point P, this radial distance is r, and the perpendicular distance is h, and the angles made by the two ends are alpha 1 and alpha 2. Okay, so now how do I go about this? So now you look at the field here. So what will be the direction of the field DE due to this small elemental length? It will be along the line joining these two, that is, it will be along R, right? And this DE I can split into two components, DEX, which is the X component, and DEY, which is the Y component. And now I want to draw your attention. Instead of thinking it as x and y component, let us just see how I can reframe. I have a component along parallel to the line charge, right? So since the line charge lies on x, dex is the component parallel to the line charge, and dey is normal to the line charge or perpendicular to the line charge, and de itself is along r. Okay, so with this geometry, let us see what we want to do. Now, what is a charge in a length dx? It is lambda into dx, because lambda is the charge density. It is coulombs per meter, and in dx meters, the total charge would be lambda into dx. Now, I can approximate it by a point charge. I can approximate it as a point charge. Okay. Now, the field at the point P, right, at dE, which I call as dE, would be q by 4 pi epsilon naught r squared. What is this q by 4 pi epsilon naught r square? This is nothing but the field due to a point charge. Since dx is very small, I can approximate it by a point charge. So now you go back to the geometry. You say, see here, theta is the angle this makes. Okay, what that is the angle made by r with respect to the x-axis. So dex would be de cos theta, and dey would be de sine theta, right? And now again from the geometry, I have, this is L1 minus x, this is L1 minus x. So this is h, this is theta. So L1 minus h I get is L1 minus x is h cot theta, right? And from this I get minus dx is equal to minus, I just differentiate this, h, differentiation of cot is cosecant minus cosecant squared theta d theta. Clear? Now what is r? Look at the geometry. Look at the geometry. Here r, I want this, this is the hypotenuse and this is the perpendicular, so therefore r square would be L1 minus x squared plus h squared. L1 is just some name I have used, that's all. Okay, this is x, so this, the point where it joins, I call this as L1 minus x, but L is the total length of the charge, right? So r is given by root of L1 minus x whole squared plus h squared. So why I'm doing this manipulation is, you can just see here. Now L1 minus h x, I have, it is equal to h cot theta. So I have h squared into 1 plus cot squared theta. So this h squared, if I take out, so this would become h squared cot squared theta. So if I take out h squared common, I get h squared into 1 plus cot squared theta, which is nothing but 1 plus cot squared theta is cosecant squared theta, right? So now I have got the value of r. So what am I trying to do here? I am trying to get expressions for different parameters in terms of theta, okay, and in terms of the perpendicular distance from the line. So what is dEx? We saw dE is lambda dx, okay, lambda, okay, 4 pi epsilon naught. I have r squared is h squared cosecant squared theta, and dEx is dE cos theta, so this cos theta is because of this, and dx, I have here lambda dx, so dx I have shown is equal to h cosecant squared theta d theta. Got it? So what have I done in this formula? This is simply lambda dx by 4 pi epsilon naught r squared, that is dE, and into cos theta is the x component. So by cancelling cosecant square theta h etc, simple cancellation if I do, I have got the x component as lambda cos theta divided by 4 pi epsilon naught h d theta. Okay, similarly the y component would be similar, only thing is instead of cos theta I would have sine theta. Right, now let's get back to my geometry and see here how theta varies. Theta varies from, so at this end what are the limits on theta? Right, if I vary dx from one end to one another end, what are the limits on theta? So at this end, so this makes an angle alpha 1, right? So as I go on moving right here, the angle is 0, okay, and as I come here, the angle this point makes is beta, it's not alpha 2, right? You see, as I go on moving this line, I move this line in this fashion, so alpha 1 goes on increasing, alpha becomes 90 degrees and then it increases beyond, and at this point alpha is beta. So my limits on the angle theta are alpha 1 and beta. And beta is what? Pi minus alpha 2. Clear? So now I have shown that the x component is, due to that small element dx, is lambda cos theta d theta by 4 pi epsilon naught h. Remember, h is the perpendicular distance. Okay? So what will be the total Ex? Due to the entire line, I know due to the small element, so I integrate dEx from theta equal to alpha 1 to beta, which is pi minus alpha 2, so I have lambda 4 pi epsilon naught h, okay, so integral cos theta, I have here integral cos theta I will get, so I'll get sine alpha 2 minus sine alpha 1, right? So this is the x component. And what was the y component? It is dE sine theta. So I have lambda sine theta divided by 4 pi epsilon naught h. Again, if I integrate, I get lambda 4 pi epsilon naught h cos alpha 1 plus cos alpha 2. Right? So if I have a finite length L, if I have a finite length L of a charged wire, let me come back to the figure. If I have a finite length L, then the x component, or the component parallel to the line, the component parallel to the line is given by, what was it? Lambda by 4 pi epsilon naught h sine of alpha 2 minus alpha 1, where alpha 1 and alpha 2 are these angles which the line makes. And similarly, the y component, or the component perpendicular to the line, is given by lambda by 4 pi epsilon naught h cos alpha 1 plus cos alpha 2. Right? Though I have used here x axis, as I told you, the result does not say x axis. You can just interpret the x component as the component parallel to the line and the y component as the component perpendicular to the line. Right, so what is the long and short of this? At any point, if you take a finite line charge, at any point if you take a finite line charge, this field, the field intensity there, will have two components, one component which is parallel to the line charge and one component which is in quadrature with the line charge. right? So this is for a finite line. Now let's see if I can extend it to an infinite line. Now firstly, the first question my students ask me is, ma'am, what is an infinite line charge? How can we have an infinite line charge, right? So now let me, you will find in many things in field theory, you will see that it, as it tends to infinity and so on. What are we talking here? Let's just see. I'll try to give you an analogy. You think of a tube light. Okay, so let us say I take a three foot fluorescent light lamp. Okay, so now if I stand at a particular distance, say if I stand about 2 meters from there, I see a finite length, right? So it is a finite length of tube. Now let's say I start moving away from the tube. As I go further and further backwards, what happens to my eye? This reduces this. So if I'm sufficiently far away, this tube light would look like a point of light from a very far distance. Agreed? Yes. So you can just see from here, our huge stars look like one speck of light, as simple as that. So that distance is only relative, how far to the size, right? So now on the other hand, so I can say now as I move towards infinity, the line charge looks like a point charge to me. It looks like a point, right? Now let me do the reverse. So I have a tube light. Now I start coming closer to it. Now I'm very close. Okay, this is 3 feet only. Now what happens if I extend my eye to whatever I can stretch on the left side? It looks as if the tube is extending forever, and on the right also it looks as if the tube is extending forever. So I'm perceiving it to look like, I perceive it to be like an infinite tube, right? So that is the concepts here. Whenever we talk of infinity, we don't actually talk of the mathematical infinity. We talk of relative distances. And these formulae we derive are valid under those considerations. Clear? So I hope I'm clear about what we mean by infinity here. The extent of perception, you can say, or you can talk of the extent of effect of a field here. So if L tends to infinity, what will happen? Just look at your figure. Now if you just think that this line extends, so as this line goes on extending, what happens to alpha 1? Alpha 1 will go on reducing and finally it becomes 0. Alpha 1 becomes 0. Right? And if I extend on this side also, alpha 2 will become 0. So as I make the line charge as an infinite charge, alpha 1 and alpha 2 will become 0. Therefore, Ex, which is sine alpha 2 minus sine alpha 1, will be 0. And I have only Ey. And what is Ey? Lambda by 4 pi epsilon naught h. Cos alpha 1 plus cos alpha 2, both are 0, so it is into 2. So I get Ey is lambda by 2 pi epsilon naught h. Now I have come to an important conclusion. What is that conclusion? What was my x component? X component was the component parallel to the line charge. That has become 0. Right? And what was the y component? That was the component which was perpendicular to the line charge. So I have only now, if I take an infinite line charge, I have only a normal component or a perpendicular component, and that is given by lambda by 2 pi epsilon naught h. Okay, the reason for this is, if the line is infinite, if I have an x component due to dx on one end, if I take a symmetrically point on the other side, these two x components will cancel. You remember what we did yesterday? If I have two charges, equal charges, then on the perpendicular bisector, I'll have only in the perpendicular direction that these two x components will cancel. It is similar to that. So I can write in general, the field due to an infinite line charge is given by lambda by 2 pi epsilon naught h a n. What is h? H is the perpendicular distance. Or if I think this line charge is the axis, then if I take a cylinder passing through the point under consideration. Then see, this is the line charge. Okay, I have a line charge like this, and this is the point where I want to find. So this is h, this perpendicular height is h, right? So now if I take a cylindrical surface around this, what would this h become? This h would be the radius of the cylinder, because the cylinder radius is always perpendicular to the axis, and an is the normal direction or the radial direction, right? So now I can easily put this formula in cylindrical coordinates and say, what do I say here? I can say in cylindrical coordinates, E is equal to rho L or lambda. Rho L, I told you, is another terminology used. As I said, I'll be using both so that you get used to different both the terminologies. And H uses rho L. And so rho L by 2 pi epsilon naught rho. What is this rho? This is your radius in cylindrical coordinates, a rho. What is a rho? The radial unit vector. Clear? So you see, it becomes very simple. So if I have a line like this, then the the field at all points is oriented radially outwards. I'm drawing your attention because in maybe tomorrow's class, I'll be dealing with Gauss law where we'll do this. So the field will be radially outwards at all points, and it is proportional to the radial distance from the line charge. And another thing I want you to see is, you know, this field intensity is inversely proportional to rho, that is the distance, whereas with a point charge it was inversely proportional to the square, r squared we had. Here it is only rho. Okay, so we know now what is the field due to a line charge. Okay, so now let's do a small problem. You consider an infinite line charge parallel to z axis at x equal to 6 and y equal to 8. Immediately you should tell me what components this will have, right? Why? I have z axis, so the line charge is proportional to is parallel to z axis. Okay, and what did we see? It will not have any component along the line charge. So which means that your field will have only x and y components. It will not have a z components. Clear? So now, any point on this charge, what will be the coordinates? X is 6, y is 8, and z can vary from minus infinity to plus infinity. So a point on the line charge will have the coordinates 6, 8, z. Now let's take any general point, field x, y, z, right? So what will be the field here? So you see, this is my z axis, this is my z axis, this is my general point x, y, z. So this is the radial distance I have to evaluate. So what would be the distance between, radial distance between these two? Okay, this is my destination, this is my source, right? It would be x minus 6 plus x minus 6 ax plus y minus 8 az plus z minus z, that is 0 az. Clear? So the if you want to know the radial distance, as I said, first write the coordinate. So the coordinate of this line charge would be 6, 8, z. And now if you arbitrarily take a point x, y, z, the radial distance would be x minus 6 ax plus y minus 8 ay. Good. That is the radial distance, x minus 6. So the magnitude of that would be root of x minus 6 whole squared plus y minus 8 whole squared. So now what is the field E at that point? Rho L, that is the charge density, divided by 2 pi epsilon naught rho. Rho is the radial distance, or you can call it as r also, right? So I have used rho because, if you remember, rho is what we used for cylindrical coordinates. So same thing, the radial distance is x minus 6 whole squared plus y minus 8 whole squared under root ar or a rho. What is this? This is the unit vector, radial unit vector. And what is the unit vector? The vector r divided by its magnitude. Okay, so I substitute for ar and this is what I get. And now you see, exactly like before, this has only an X component and a Y component, it will not have a Z component. Okay, clear? Simple. This is one, this is a simple problem. So now let's look at another problem. A uniform line charge of 16 nanocoulombs is located along the line defined by y equal to minus 2 and z equal to 5. Quickly tell me which components it will have. Yes, it will have only y and z components. It will not have an x component because this line is parallel to the x axis. As simple as that, right? So I want the field at point 1, 2, 3, right? Don't even bother about the x component. If you have a doubt here, how do I take the radial distance 1, 2, 3? There are two ways you can do it. First, write expression for the field for a general point x, y, z. Then what would be the point of this line charge? It would be x minus 2 and 5. X minus 2 and 5. So here you have an x. X and x will cancel, right? Otherwise, simply remember this. I have a line charge. The line charge is parallel to the x axis, so it will not have an x component, right? So in your radial vector, x component will not feature. So only take the y and z components. In the previous problems, we took only x and y and we didn't take z. Right, so what will be RP? Right, it is 0, x component will be 0, and this is 2 minus of minus 2, which is 4, right, and I have 3 minus 5, which is minus 2. So I told you, when I write a vector in this fashion, 0, 4, minus 2, as opposed to a point, what does this vector notation mean? Yes, Haight uses it and you'll be using that book. Please know this. This means the vector is 0ax plus 4ay minus 2az. It is not the point. It's not the point. Okay. So the magnitude of this is root of 16 plus 4. Right. So RP squared is 20. Therefore, E is lambda into 2 pi epsilon naught, the radial distance. And then again, I have the unit vector. If you look at this formula here, I have rho, and a rho would be the vector divided by rho. So I can just take rho squared and the vector on top, just like how we did for point charges. We took r cubed. Here I can take as rho squared, right? So rho squared is 20 and the vector is 4ay minus 2az, and so this is the electric field at this point, right? So now, find E at that point in the z equal to 0 plane where the direction of E is given by the same problem. It's a continuation, 1 by 3 ay minus 2 by 3 az. Okay, so what are we telling here? Find E at the point in z equal to 0 plane. So z equal to 0 plane means what? So here y is minus 2, right? X is varying and z is equal to 0, right? In that plane I want to find out. So if z is equal to 0, what will be the general field? Rho L by 2 pi epsilon naught. And what is my point? My point is 2. Right, so I have 2 plus, so z is equal to 0 means x and y will vary, so I'll have y plus 2 ay minus 5 az. Just see here, this is minus 2, right? So I have y plus 2 and I have z is equal to 0, so I'll have 5 minus 0. So this will be the field at any point on the plane where z is equal to 0. And what is my requirement? I want the y component to be 2 times that of the z component. And what is the y component here? If you look at the y component, it is y plus, see, this is common to both z and y components, and the y component proportion would be y plus 2 divided by this denominator, right? I want that to be equal to 2 times this. So I basically I'll have E2, I want it to be Ez to be minus 2 times Ey. So 2 times of y plus 2 should be equal to 5. Right? The y component is, this should be double. And so I solve for this and I get y is equal to half. Don't get confused, you work it out. Very simple. I have just given you the specification. If you look at this, Ay is 1 by 3 times and A2 is 2 by 3. This is a unit vector, right? I want the unit vector. I have the unit vector in the Y and Z. And the Y component is half of the Z component. So this is the Y component and this is the Z component. So this is half of this, or this is twice this. So 5 should be 2 times of y plus 2. With that I solve for y and substitute in this. I get a general expression for the value of E at a point z equal to 0, at the plane z equal to 0. Clear? So why I'm showing you this is, you can find, you know, you can find the field at different points. But one thing is, you know, instead of taking a line arbitrarily, see, I can have a line joining any two points in space. For example, I can have a, I can say I can have a line charge, you know, passing through some two points, x1, y1, z1 and x2, y2, z2 and all. So you'll have to do a little bit of geometrical jugglery to find the field. But mostly for you, you would have the line charge in your problems, even in your exam, the line charge parallel in general to one of the axes. Okay, so the only thing you have to remember is the field at any point will not have a component which is parallel to this axis, or this axis component it will not have. So just remember that when you solve the problems. Okay, now I have one more. I have infinite uniform line charge lying along the x-axis in free space, right? One line charge in x-axis, while I have point charges located at two points. So now we are having a mixture of charges. So I have two point charges and one line charge, and I want you to find the electric field E at point 2, 3, minus 4. Remember I told you yesterday, the field E obeys superposition. Repeat, the field E obeys superposition. Okay, therefore I just have to find the field due to all the points, right? So now I have 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. I have just taken it as common. You know the formula. Formula is very simple, right? For the point charge, it is Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R squared. And for the line charge, it is lambda by 2 pi epsilon naught R or rho, right? I am only interested in the distances. So now this is my point under consideration. So between this and the first point charge, the distance is what? 2 minus 0 ax, this one, 2 minus 0 ax, 2 ax, 3 minus 0 plus 3 ay, minus 4 or minus of minus 1, that is minus 4 plus 1, okay, sorry, minus 4 minus 1, which is 0, sorry, which is minus 5, so minus 5 az. So between this point and this charge, it is 2 ax plus 3 ay minus 5 az. And between these two, this is 0, 0, 1 and this is 0, 0, minus 1. So the x and y components remain the same. So now it is minus 4 minus of minus 1, which is minus 3 az. So this is the vector distance between the first point charge and the point. And this is the vector distance between the second point charge and the point. Now I need the radial distance between this and my line charge. So my line charge is lying along the x-axis in free space, right? So what are the coordinates of the line charge? It would be x, 0, 0. right? The line charge is actually lying on the x-axis itself. So the coordinates of the line charge would be x, 0, 0. And when you want to find the radial distance, remember what I told you, don't consider the component which is along the line charge. So don't take the x component, that won't come in your radial distance. So what is the component now? 3 minus 0, so it will be 3ay minus 4az. So 3ay minus 4az is the radial vector from the line charge to the point, right? I have multiplied this by 2 because I have taken 4 pi epsilon naught common, whereas for a line charge the field is 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught, right? So this is r squared, radial distance squared, that is root of 3 squared plus 4 squared is 5, so this is 5 squared, 25. And between the first charge, the radial distance is root of 4 plus 9 plus 25, that is 38, so this becomes root 38 cubed, that is 38 to the power of 3 by 2. And the second charge, the distance is root of 4 plus 9 plus 9, that is root 22, so this is root 22 whole cubed, which is 22 to the power of 3 by 2. And now by simplifying this, I get my field. Clear? So here the only place where students make mistake in my 30 years of teaching field theory is in this, in computing the vectors. Okay, and you as a beginner, please do not write one equation like how I have done. I have done it because I want everything in one slide to explain. Please do it charge by charge. Find the field due to the first point charge. You know the formula. Q by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. Then find the field due to the second charge. Then find the field due to the line charge and then add. If you try to do it in one shot like this, 101% you will make a mistake. Okay, so now you got some idea about a line charge. So now let's go to a surface charge, infinite surface charge. Same thing, infinite surface charge. You know, I have a surface which is charged, right? From a distance I can see the surface. As I move further and further away, this whole surface will look like a point at very large distances. And when I come and put my hand, you know, very close to it, I'll see the surface extending on all sides. So it appears to be infinite to me, right? So that is the relative distance. So now we will solve these in a slightly different way. So for simplicity, I will take a circular disc, right? A circular disc for my surface. It has no volume, it's not a sphere, it's a circular disc, right? And look at the geometry I'm taking. I take a small annular ring, right? The radius, the ring from the center is at a distance r, and the width of the ring is dr, right? And I take a point along the axis, h, okay? I take along the h, so that perpendicular height is h. Now from the disc I join to that point, that distance I call as r, capital R. And from the edge I join it, I call that as another radius r, and the radius of the disc is a. Simple geometry, that's all. So I have a disc, I have considered a point, this perpendicular height is h, okay? And I have taken a small annular ring, so this distance is r, and from the edge of the disc is capital R. Right, and the radius of the disc is a. This is how we do it. So now this makes an angle theta, right? And let us say theta varies up to alpha. From zero, at this point it is zero, and at this point it is alpha. That is, from the center angle theta is zero, and at the edge the angle is alpha. So as I move from the center along, so I have the disc, so what I'm trying to do is I'll try to integrate the effect as I move from the center of disc towards the edge. That's what we are planning to do in this derivation. Okay. Okay. D is sigma ds. What is sigma? Sigma is the charge density into the area ds divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r squared. Now look at this. Yeah, if I assume this is the xy plane, I assume this is the xy plane, right? So this x component, if I take a small annular part here, I'll have here, so the field due to both, you know, the x components will cancel. So what is the x component? The component parallel to the surface. So I'll be left only with the perpendicular component. Okay, so that would be into cos theta. So now let's try to do some geometry. This is a simple equation. So here what have I used? I have used the formula of a point charge. Why point charge? Because as I told you, if I take a small amount, it looks like a point charge. So now let us see what I did. I took an annular ring, right? So what would be the area of that small annular ring? 2 pi r, it's at a radial distance r, so that is the circumference, into dr. So this is the surface area of the annular ring, and sigma is the charge density. So the numerator is done. Now r is equal to h tan theta, same as before. This one, r is equal to this radial distance r, and this is h. So r is equal to h tan theta. Okay, and this capital R here, this capital R here, that would be the hypotenuse. See, this is the perpendicular height, and the radial distance is along the surface, and so this will be the hypotenuse. So this H, R and capital R, these three form a right angled triangle. That's all I'm trying to use here. So this radial distance R, this is equal to H tan theta, and this will be equal to sine R sine theta. So R is H tan theta, so dr will be H secant square theta d theta, and this is the perpendicular distance into R, this would be sine theta. So now I will substitute for the y component. Just here sigma, I have sigma, I have ds. Ds is 2 pi r dr, cos theta is there, 4 pi epsilon naught, r squared, which r am I talking of? This r squared, this is a distance between this small portion here dr and this point, this is the distance, capital R. Okay, so that is, if you look at this, it is r by sine theta whole squared cos theta. Right, and I'm also substituting in the next substitution, I'm substituting for dr. What is dr? H secant square theta d theta. So I have here sigma 2 pi r cos theta, 4 pi epsilon naught, r by sine theta whole squared, and dr is h secant square theta d theta. Simple, just a geometrical manipulation. So I cancel out all whatever is required in all the terms, and I get the y component is sigma by 2 epsilon naught sine theta d theta. Right, and what is sine theta? What is theta? It is 0 from at the center, and it is equal to alpha at the edge. Therefore I have sigma by 2 epsilon naught into 1 minus cos alpha. Now look at this, theta is 0 here and theta is alpha here. So what will be this alpha? This alpha. So this radius is r, this radius is r, and this perpendicular distance is h, sorry, this radius is a, that is the radius of the disc. R is the radius of this annular section. So this is a and this is h, therefore this is alpha, right? So therefore I can write cos alpha is h by a squared plus h squared, I get ey. So now I want to draw your attention to this. So if I have a disc, right, and at the field at any point on its axis, the field at any point on its axis will have a component only along the axis. It will not have any component along the surface that is parallel to the surface. So if your charge is, you know, if your surface is in the xz plane, right, if your surface is in the xz plane, then your field will be having only a y component. Right, now if your surface is in the yx plane, then your field will have only a z component. Okay, and look at the expression for the field. What all does it depend on? It depends on the perpendicular distance on the axis and on the radius of the disk. Clear up to this point? Fine. And the direction is normal. Agreed. Next, what I want to do, what happens if the surface is infinite? If the surface is infinite, what will happen? So what happens, look at this, this angle is zero, right? Now as I go on, this angle is alpha. Now supposing this surface goes on becoming infinity, then what will happen? Alpha will, you know, will tend to, look at this, this is zero between this perpendicular, and here it is alpha. Which angle is alpha? This angle, okay, is alpha. And as I go on extending it to infinity, what will happen? This angle will become 90 degrees. So I'll have only sigma by 2 epsilon naught. Right? So now I want to draw your attention to this. What is that? Or you can even do something very simple. You can just see here. As the surface tends to infinity, what will happen? A will tend to infinity. Right? So this term will become 0. So I'll be left only with sigma by 2 epsilon naught. Right? You needn't even think of alpha or cos or anything like that. So now, look at this. Very interesting. What does it say? I put it in red because it's very important. The field due to an infinite charge surface is independent of the distance of the point from the charge. So you just see here, I have only sigma by 2 epsilon naught. And the field is directed normal to the surface charge. So we saw, for a point charge, the field is inversely proportional to R squared. For a line charge, it's inversely proportional to R. And for a surface charge, it is independent of R. It has, so a large surface charge would give you a uniform field around it. Right? And that field is equal to sigma by 2 epsilon naught, where epsilon naught is the permittivity of the medium. So here it's epsilon naught because it is free space or vacuum. So in any other medium, it would be the permittivity of the medium. Very interesting, right? So what can you do? Just see a very simple, I have put one simple example. Let us say I have two infinite sheet charges with a density of sigma, and they are located at x is equal to plus or minus 1 m. So I admit I am not very good at drawing. Anyway, I have tried to put it here. So see, this is x-axis, right? Now I have an infinite sheet of charge here, right, at x equal to 1, and an infinite sheet of charge here at x equal to minus 1, right? Remember, I told you first always draw the figure, configurations. Lot of things will be clear. So now, what is the field due to this? We know the field due to both is sigma by 2 epsilon naught. Let's get the direction. What is the direction at any point? It will be normal to this surface. So I have a surface at x equal to 1. So for all points this side, the field is oriented like this. And for all points this side, the field is oriented like this. Right? So this is the surface. And all points here, it is E1. E1 is due to this, I call this as the charge 1, is like this, and here it is in this direction, oriented away normally from the charge. If it is negative, it will be oriented towards it. Now here what happens? Here similarly, all the field on this side will be like this, E2, and on this side will be like this. Okay, so now let's see here, both the fields are equal. E1 and E2 are both equal to sigma by 2 epsilon naught, the magnitude, right? So on this side, if you see, so for all points on this side, E1 is like this. So E1 is here and E2 is here. So these two fields add up, right? Now look at the center. E1, due to this, it will be in this direction, and due to this sheet, it will be in this direction. So E1 and E2, so they are in opposite directions. So the field here will be zero. It will cancel out. And look here, the field due to this is like this, and the field due to this, for all points this side, it is like this. So these two also add up, but they are in the minus AX direction. So I have the field, how do I write the solution? For X greater than 1, the field, these two will add up. So it will be sigma by epsilon naught AX. And here, between minus 1 and 1, the field is 0, and greater than, sorry, lesser than minus 1, it would be sigma by epsilon naught minus ax. So this minus is not because of sigma, this minus is because of the direction, minus because it is in the minus ax direction. Clear? So it is very easy for you to find out the direction of a surface charge. It is normal. Okay, so I'll quickly wind up. Today we saw two important configurations, the line charge and the surface charge, and an infinite line charge. The magnitude of the field at a point is given by lambda by 2 pi epsilon naught rho, and it is in the radial direction, that is normal to the line charge. And the field due to a surface charge which is infinite in extent is sigma by 2 epsilon naught, which is a constant, and it is oriented normal to the surface. So with this I end today's class.